In May of 2012, the NCI Division of Cancer Epidemiology and Genetics hosted Dr. David Schottenfeld as a visiting scholar. David has collaborated with several scientists in the division. In particular, he and our former division director, Dr. Joseph Fraumeni, have collaborated since they first met over 50 years ago. Over this time, they have both ascended to legendary status as epidemiologists, including co-editing three editions of the definitive textbook of cancer epidemiology. Here are some highlights from a panel discussion which focused on their personal reflections on the field of epidemiology over the past half century and their thoughts on future directions. Excluding each other, your mentors, and others in this room, who were the three or four cancer epidemiologists you have known who have made the most important contributions to our field, and what were those contributions?
Well, I think Richard Dahl stood out. He is a towering figure in cancer epidemiology and in epidemiology in general. He was, along with Ernie Winder, the first to really pin down the relationship between smoking and lung cancer. But his contributions extended well beyond that particular finding, which is probably the landmark finding in cancer epidemiology. He looked into occupational cancers. He was really the first, I believe, the first to carry out a cohort study of asbestos workers. And he had other occupational carcinogens that he discovered. He had tremendous influence over the field, over cancer research generally. And one other person I'd like to mention is Bill Hensel, who was chief of the biometry branch when I arrived. His work on migrant studies, I think, was so key to our understanding of cancer etiology.
I want to mention another name. That was Austin Bradford-Hill. His introduction of principles of medical statistics, he had an enormous impact on the medical profession, which tended not to think numerically or quantitatively, and he kind of laid out in what I would call the introductory principles of biostatistics.
Other than the contributions noted for the luminaries that you've discussed, what findings over the last 50 years do you think are particularly notable?
When I got here in, which was 1962, exactly 50 years ago, cancer seemed like a black box. Except for smoking, the hazards of smoking, and particularly lung cancer, very little was known about the causes of cancer. And then there was a succession of epidemiological discoveries that seemed to appear. Part of it was due to the waves of fashion, ideological fashion that we went through. In the 1960s, the emphasis was on viruses. In the 1970s, fashion changed, and it was environmental and occupational hazards. And all this time, genetics was really underground. There were very few people studying genetics. 1980s, lifestyle took over, particularly diet, and there were debates as to what was in the diet that was causing cancer. In the 1990s, the genomic revolution occurred, and finally our basic scientists were coming up with tools that we could use in epidemiology, and this was there was an explosion of work in family-based studies with high-penetrant genes, and then GWAS, exciting findings from GWAS on the low-penetrant common genetic variants, but then there were also individual discoveries that all added up, and radiation. I can't forget radiation, the work of Gil Beebe at the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission, now called the Radiation Effects Research Foundation, the classic study of the atom bomb survivors, which still goes on to this day.
Okay, kind of lighten up the conversation a little bit. Over your career, who were the most notable characters in our field, and what made them so interesting? David?
Well, you almost know what I'm going to say. Ernst Wender. Ernst Wender, when he was a medical student at Washington University, was approached by Ewart's Graham, who was a thoracic surgeon, about doing a study on tobacco and lung cancer. And Ernst took it over, did a case control study, and published, while in medical school, in 1950, a paper that underscored the association. Ernst, who was Germanic in his manner, was flamboyant, charismatic, and at times infuriating. But he had endless ideas. The only issue was, you pursue them. But he was enormously productive, hundreds and hundreds of publications. And he also was not beyond bringing a Hollywood starlet into a professional staff dining room and saying, hi, boys. and this beautiful model would come into the room, and you'd keep shaking your head about Ernst Wender. So he was a notable character.
If you had only one piece of advice to give to a young investigator starting his or her career, what would that be?
Some of these relate to their personal attributes and qualities and approach to their discipline. And I made the point, if you really want to be serious about it, you better acknowledge the fact that you're going to be a lifelong student, that you're going to have to continue to learn and to continue to master your methodology and to experience passion and joy while you're doing it. If you don't have it, don't trouble yourself with all the years that you're going to have to compete for funding. Also to encourage them to be questioning, to be critical observers, and ultimately, and I mentioned this to them, to think out of the box, to think imaginatively about questions, because it's framing the question that's really the issue.
Joseph?
Well, I think finding the best possible mentor that you can have, and mentor is so important in our field, and also carving out a niche where you can gradually evolve and mature and become an authority in that particular field, I think is important. Despite the fact that we know so much more than we did 50 years ago, there's still a lot that remains to be learned. We just have to seize every opportunity that comes along. Not every opportunity, but the best and most exciting opportunities that are out there.